Hi, I'm Chris Spizak, and this is the Words You Should Know podcast. A few stolen minutes out of your day to talk words and communication, because our daily lives are surrounded by the evolution of and the influence of words. Forget the grammar police. There is so much more to this conversation. And as a reminder, free downloads of fiction editing cheat sheets, family writing references, and business communication tips are all available on my website, getagriponyourgrammar.com. Welcome to episode number 36, where we'll revel in the glory of defying every teacher who ever told you to avoid contractions in formal writing. The line's not quite so black and white, and history lends so much more to this discussion. But first, here's the latest in word, language, and writing news. One trend I've been noticing lately is the popularity of grammar. Yes, you heard me right, and I'm not just saying this as the author of a grammar book. I'm saying this because the concept of grammar, as in the core structure of things, has recently been hijacked. No, too strong of a word. Let's go with borrowed in conversations in so many different areas of expertise. Phys.org, among others, phys as in physics, P-H-Y-S, recently published an article about the grammar of DNA. Atlas Obscura recently published a piece on food grammar, the unspoken rules of everyday cuisine. As much of this concept of grammar might sound either boring or remind us of ferocious red ink marks all over past tests and essays from our school years, it's something we all need. It's something we crave. Structure, methodology, knowing the rules of the game so we can all play it well together. Oh, the glamour of grammar. Oh, wait, we've already had that conversation. And as clickbait for you for one of those articles, just take a moment with this line from the mentioned Atlas Obscura article. Technically, spaghetti and meatballs is bad grammar. Did anybody else just do a double take? All of these links, of course, are in my show notes at getagriponyourgrammar.com. Ah, grammar. Now, two other quick language news stories to mention. First, let's go with another story that made me do a double take, and this one had nothing to do with spaghetti and meatballs. In trying to understand language processing and how our brains function, a PhD student in computer science at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, along with his colleagues at the MIT IBM Watson AI Lab, have created a simulated fruit fly brain, which has learned to perform natural language processing tasks. Now, this is not a standalone device. They literally hacked into a fruit fly's brain. Seriously. To quote from the article, it matches the performance of artificial learning networks while using far fewer computational resources. Yep, the brain is a magnificent thing. The human brain, the fruit fly brain. My brain is again slightly blown by this research. Again, to quote the article, the first time a naturally occurring network has been commandeered in this way. Hijacking the brain, looking at language use. You can read more via Discover Magazine in the link, of course, in my show notes. And our last news story of the day. Returning to the idea of the imperative nature of correct grammar, a case was just decided by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit because of the usage of the phrase a plurality of, followed by a series held together with the word and versus the word or. So to be clear, we're talking about the difference between the plurality of A, B, and C versus a plurality of A, B, or C. Also in this debate, the changing of meaning with the inclusion of the article the. I won't go into all the details of this case, SIMO Holdings Incorporated versus Hong Kong UCloud Network Technology Limited. Follow the links for more details where the findings specifically refer to how the plurality of each recited component was at odds with the claim language based on the application of grammatical rules. Words matter, folks. Spoken, written, or however you're communicating. And we're not going into legal communications today as we turn to English language history and trivia, but we will go into the formality of our language use. Specifically, let's talk contractions. If you were writing a legal brief, as one example, those teachers you had in middle school were absolutely right. That's not the time or place for contractions. However, are contractions something you should always avoid? What about business emails? What about dialogue in your fiction? What about the antiquated ones like tis and twas, or the regionalisms like y'all and you'uns? What does Shakespeare have to say about this? William Shakespeare loved contractions. Just look at his contractions, including the word it alone. We have tis, twas, twill, twould. Sure, their modern counterparts would be its, it'll, and the less popular but still use itted, it apostrophe d, but many of his contractions are ones we still commonly use. For example, those linked with forms of the verb to be, like she'll, we'll, theirs, he's, and I'm. But while we often speak of Shakespeare when we're talking about the roots of our present-day English language, we need to go much, much further back, all the way to the days of Old English, before English was even written in Latin letters. Because remember, Old English was originally written in the runic alphabet. Now, if you're reading along in the transcript of this episode, please forgive me that I'm not writing any Old English in the runic alphabet, because I'll be clear, I don't know it. But I'm guessing you don't either, so I'm hoping we'll all be okay with the modern alphabet versions of these words. Don't you love disclaimers? Anyway, even Old English gives us contractions. Nis, for example, is the contraction of nay is, or is not, or isn't, to a modern English speaker. The Old English word nold came from nay wold, meaning would not or wouldn't. And oh yeah, there is an L in that form of the word would even then. Middle English has plenty of contractions too. Just looking at Canterbury Tales, a go-to for Middle English usage, we have newt, a contraction of ne woot, meaning knows not, and ne'er, a contraction coming from ne were, meaning were not or weren't. There's even some contraction gems in there, like thilk from the ilk, meaning the same, and, wait for it, sit from sitteth, as in to put one's backside down, yes, the same definition of sit today. So, long story short, please don't be tricked by the common misunderstanding that contractions are simply signs of contemporary language laziness. Are they appropriate in all situations? Perhaps not. If you're writing for an academic audience or a cover letter to be attached to your resume for a job application, these might be instances of skipping the Titan form. But this is equally true for other reduced forms, like clipped word forms, pro for professional, for example. And as a special note for the historical fiction writers out there, please don't try to sound old-fashioned by dropping all of your contractions and writing your dialogue more formally. It often comes off as more stilted than authentic, and it's not historically accurate. People use contractions. It is okay. And fun fact, the contraction ain't was actually considered fine English until the Victorian period, so the late 1800s. This was when a lot of contractions started to seem lesser, lower class, or less educated. Oh, Victorians, come on, y'all. And speaking of y'all, which originated in the American South in the 1800s and moved out west, we can also look at other tightenings like you-ins or yin's, not quite contractions with apostrophes involved, but on the same wavelength. You-ins and yin's both came to be in the early 1800s in what's sometimes called the American Old Northwest, as in Ohio and Pennsylvania. Now, some contractions might require a moment more of pause in their written use, like she'd have, for she would have, something one might not even notice when spoken, but that looks a bit complicated on paper. S-H-E, apostrophe, D, apostrophe, V-E. She'd have. Let's wrap this up with an Elizabethan contraction I argue we should bring back. Withed, as in with it. If you wanted to be really with it, or should we say withed? You should know when and how you can use your contractions. Yep, withed. That's W-I-T-H apostrophe T. Was this Shakespearean slang? Let's be clear, it was not. But maybe we can bring it back with a new twist. Feeling withed? Okay, maybe not. But we do live in such a fast-paced world. Does our usage of contractions speed up our communications even more? Who knows? But it's good to know the legacy of our language. For today's language challenge, do you want to use contractions in your communications? Are you want to do this? Are these two words in these two sentences spelled the same, want and want? Let me repeat that. Do you want to use contractions in your communications? Are you want to do so? Are these two words spelled the same, or are they different? The answers, as always, can be found on my website, getagripponyourgrammar.com. For my personal update today, I don't know what it is about this moment, whether it's the fact that it's cold and bleak winter time, whether it's the fact that the pandemic is still hitting hard, whether it's just a coincidence, but I've had the joy recently of past fiction editing clients reaching back out to me en masse in the past week or so. The creative drive is there. Stories are inside of us. Now, some of these conversations have been about revisions. Some of these have just been about ideas. Some of these conversations have just been catching up. But where there are stories waiting to be told, aching to come out, it's time to get them right and then send them on their way out into the world, whatever that route happens to be for any given writer. Traditional publication with literary agents, pitching to top publishers, indie publishing with grit, savvy, and tenacity. Anything and everything in between, maybe just capturing your own memoir or your family history. Now, the editorial relationship, at least for me, always feels like a deeply personal one. I have the opportunity to explore the ideas hidden in the wrinkles of my clients' brains and to help their projects evolve into the books we both know they can be. But something about the past week or two, what is it? The 2021 groundhog prediction claims we're in for a long winter. Thanks for that, Punxsutawney Phil. But the spark of creativity endures. It seems to be heating up. It's on fire in so many of us. If that includes you, let's all keep going, whatever that spark may hold for you. Ne'er a day may pass that I'm not inspired by the storytellers. 'Tis true. Am I going too far or just too far back in time? What's your take on contractions in your own writing? Or what's your own midwinter creative spark? Get in touch. I'd love to hear all about it. Are you curious or confused about the words you use every day? For more information on language news, trivia, tips, and explorations, I invite you to sign up for my monthly newsletter at getagriponyourgrammar.com. That's also a great place for free communication, story writing, and story research downloads, and to learn more about my books, Get a Grip on Your Grammar, the Novel Editing Workbook, and the Family Story Workbook. Thank you so much to those of you who have taken the time to review or rate this podcast. Believe it or not, something as simple as tapping on the stars can have a huge impact on the visibility of a show, just like reviews and ratings make a big difference on bookseller websites like Amazon. If you haven't yet subscribed or rated the Words You Should Know podcast, why don't you head over to wherever you listen and do so? I'm grateful for it. Until next time, words, language, communication. We've got this.